Welcome to From Newcastle, a podcast featuring the latest developments in health, science, culture, and the creative arts from Newcastle University. In this series, From Newcastle for Engagement, we'll hear about how our teaching and research is shared, enriched and enhanced through partnerships and collaborations working beyond the university. Discover the different ways in which our work is having a positive impact, improving the economy, health, social well-being, and the cultural richness of the places in which we operate. Hi, I'm James, and you're listening to the From Newcastle podcast. Today, I will be talking to Dr. Mark Jackson and Valentina Flex about a new exhibition at the Great North Museum, Hancock, Challenging Legacies, The Kingdom of Iraq and Gertrude Bell. In this episode, we will learn about the history of the Gertrude Bell Archive and why it is so important to Newcastle University and how this groundbreaking exhibition was put together. So welcome, Mark and Valentina. Welcome to the From Newcastle podcast. So firstly, like on all of our episodes, we like to ask our guests to introduce yourselves, but also like give a short overview of your work.
Hello, I'm Mark Jackson. I'm senior lecturer in archaeology. And I guess my main role is teaching and researching the archaeology, particularly the medieval period in the Eastern Roman Empire. So Eastern Mediterranean and the Middle East.
And I'm Valentina Flex, and I am the Gertrude Bell Project Archivist. My job as part of the Gertrude Bell and the Kingdom of Iraq at 100 project is cataloguing the archive. So looking at all of the existing information about the archive, refining and improving it, making it kind of up to current archival standards. And I have also curated the exhibition at the Great North Museum, Challenging Legacies, the Kingdom of Iraq and Gertrude Bell.
So could you tell us a bit about your backgrounds and how you got into these areas of work?
Yeah, I did an undergraduate degree in archaeology, actually at Newcastle. And so we had a lecturer who taught about particularly Turkey and the archaeology of Turkey. And a friend and I thought we might like to travel to Turkey and see some of the archaeology we were learning about in lessons and lectures. So we went to see this lecturer, and he got out a map of Turkey, put it on his floor, got down on his hands and knees and was poring over this map saying, you should go here, you should go here. And then he turned to a cupboard in the corner of his room and he pulled out all these photographs and he said, these are the photographs taken by Gertrude Bell nearly 100 years ago. This was back in the 1990s. Why don't you go in her footsteps and visit some of these sites? So that was nearly 30 years ago, and I guess I've been interested in Gertrude Bell ever since.
Mine is quite a long story, so strap in. So I did my undergraduate degree at the University of Liverpool. I did English and music, which I loved, but obviously I didn't really know what I wanted to do. Then I went to Edinburgh, which is where I'm from, and did a master's degree in modern literature. And while I was there, I found out that there was a special collections and that they had a collection of material from W.H. Auden, who I loved. So I went along and I said, can I see some of this? Like, I was really nervous because I'd never been to special collections before. I didn't really know how it worked. I felt like I didn't belong there because I didn't know what to say, how to ask for things. And they were very lovely, which is really important because I could easily have been a bit scared and then just left. And they said, well, actually, the collection is not catalogued yet, but our rare books librarian, once they passed the request on, they said she would be interested in, if you would like to, having you to volunteer to help list it. And I was like, oh, that would be amazing. So I started off doing listing of the rare books collection of Auden. And then I moved on to some kind of other unprocessed donations. And I'm sorry, I know this is a long story, but it's a good one.
No, it's interesting.
So in some of the Auden books, I'd recognised some initials. And when I did some of the unprocessed books that were unrelated, I did find a book that was one of Auden's contemporaries, and it had initials in it as well, and it had a letter. And the letter was from Christopher Isherwood, who was the writer of the book, to this person with these initials. And I was like, who's this? And I asked, and I was trying to Google it and finding nothing. And someone, the rare books librarian, Elizabeth, who's lovely, she said, Valentina, we're in a library. Like, why don't you go and find an Isherwood biography and look in the index? And I thought, I'm thinking of that. So turned out that the initials belonged to a the Dean of Law at one time at the university, and they had his papers. And would I like to do some volunteering listing those? So I did that, and I just absolutely loved it. And then I was lucky enough to get a job as an archives assistant. And I was like, I didn't know that this was a job. I didn't know that you could be an archivist. This is great. And while I was there, I was very lucky to have all my colleagues support me. And I went to dropped to part-time so that I could go and do my archives degree. And now I'm a qualified archivist. So I saw
That's quite the snowball effect, isn't it? Just by initial interest and then...
And I think that, like, there's a lot of emphasis on people, like, oh, so what do you want to do with your degree? And sometimes you don't know until you find it. Like, I've found it now and I know that I've found it, but you don't know. But all the work that I did do really prepared me for the job that I do
now. It's quite, like, serendipitous, isn't it? Like,
yeah, it totally is. And it shows the importance of feeling that you can go to archives and special collections and the importance of having friendly people as a first point of contact if you don't know what you're doing, because I didn't know what I was doing.
For our listeners who like might not be aware, could you tell us about the Great North Museum Hancock and its relationship with the university?
Yeah, the Great North Museum is an enormous museum on campus.
Beautiful building
at Newcastle
as well.
University, a wonderful old building. It has a whole series of different collections in it, including the collections of the Natural History Society of Newcastle, but also the Society of Antiquaries. So lots and lots of archaeological artefacts from the region. It's got a library upstairs, and it's also got temporary exhibition spaces. And I guess one of the great things for the university is it brings lots of people onto campus to see the material in the museum, but also it's an opportunity for us. It's a bit like a front window. We can share our research and some of the really exciting things happening on campus through that kind of front window. And so you find that among the kind of permanent exhibitions, there are all kinds of temporary exhibitions where academics are talking about what they're doing in a whole range of different areas.
So today, this podcast episode is you're here to talk about the current exhibition at the museum, which is called Challenging Legacies, The Kingdom of Iraq and Gertrude Bell. So who was Gertrude Bell, and also why is she important to the university?
Gertrude Bell came from the northeast of England. So she was born in Washington, and when she was quite young, she moved to Redcar with her father, who had just bought a house there. And so she grew up in the northeast of England, part of a really wealthy family. They'd made a lot of money making iron, particularly. So in that sort of 19th century, second half of the 19th century, they'd made a huge amount of money. And so she went off to Oxford, having been schooled first at home and then in London, and really benefited from that family wealth. So she was really interested in travelling, wasn't she? So she travelled all around the world, but particularly from about 1899 through to the outbreak of the First World War, she was travelling in what was then the Ottoman Empire. So she's travelling in places in the Middle East that were to be radically transformed during the First World War, and particularly after the First World War, when the Ottoman Empire fell and the Middle East was kind of carved up by foreign powers. So because of the travels that she'd done before the First World War, during the war she worked for British military intelligence. So she was recruited to advise on things like where the tribes were in the deserts. And having been initially based in Egypt in 1915, early in 1916, she was sent to what was then Mesopotamia. So she spent she died in 1926, that final kind of decade of her life. She was based in what was to become in 1921 Iraq. And she was instrumental in forming that new state.
As someone who's kind of come to Gertrude Bell like fairly recently in comparison to Mark, who's been aware of her for a long time, I would say that if we're answering the question, who was Gertrude Bell, I'd say she was many things. And there are certain aspects of her personality and her work that we maybe talk about more. But then you have to kind of remember there's all these other parts too. So the exhibition fills you in a little bit about her earlier life, but then it looks at her first trip to Iraq and then her role in the First World War and the formation of the Kingdom of Iraq, as Mark's alluded to. But it only touches upon other things just because there's not enough room in the world. For example, she did a lot of archaeological work. She was very interested and engaged in that. We have a lot of correspondence of hers with other contemporaries in that field. She also did a lot of mountaineering before she went to the Middle East. So it's kind of like lots of different like kind of adventures that she went on. So she did that. She was incredibly good with languages. She translated Persian poetry into English. And she also learned like German and French. And she was an incredible writer, which I think that's like she's got volumes of archaeological work and then also like travelogues published. But I think that we kind of forget, because we're focused on the content of that, which is really interesting, sometimes the form is neglected. So one of the first things when I got this job, I thought, well, I better learn about Gertrude Bell. So I got a volume of her like kind of collected works that Penguin published. And I felt that the key to understanding them absolutely was knowledge of the places, which I didn't have yet. But what struck me was how evocative her writing is. It's beautiful. It's really, really good. So, of course, there's the kind of political work, writing reports, collecting intelligence for the Arab Bureau in the First World War. The diplomatic work she did in the formation of the Kingdom of Iraq. So she was at the Cairo Conference and the Paris Peace Conference and was very involved in kind of championing and supporting the first monarch of the country. But there was all these other facets to her character. She was also anti-suffrage, which people find very interesting because she's a strong woman, and that doesn't really kind of marry up with what you would imagine a strong woman would, what their ideals would be. And the other part of the question was, why is she important to Newcastle University? So we have the Gertrude Bell Archive and Special Collections here. We also have her kind of personal and working library, her collection. They were donated to the university by her family after her death. So that is probably the biggest reason why she's important to us. But she's, as Mark said, she's also fairly local. She was born in Washington. But the archive is hugely important, not just for the university and for us here, but internationally. It spans so many countries, continents, decades, and really important geopolitical events. And it's also on the UNESCO Memory of the World Register as well. So that's probably the primary reason why she's incredibly important to us.
So obviously we're here to talk about the exhibition. So how did this first come about? You know, was the initial conversation, sort of who first had the idea to put on this exhibition?
Well, it kind of came back even before that, because it came about because we had a benefaction from a very generous American donor who gave us money that enabled us to begin to digitise the archive. And so that started with photographs, and then it led on to a second gift, which enabled us to employ Valentina. And so it was as part of that second gift, really, that when we put forward a list of things that we might do to our benefactor, he said, well, let's do them all. And the sort of the culmination of that archival process was to put on this exhibition. And so when Valentina was appointed to that role, it became one of the key parts of the sort of final part of your work, wasn't
it? Yeah, so that was always, an exhibition was always on the table and the cards. The narrative and the topic of the exhibition and the size of the exhibition wasn't obviously fixed. So we were aware that in 2021, it was the 100th anniversary, centenary of the creation of the Kingdom of Iraq and the crowning of King Faisal. So although we'd missed that kind of because of COVID, like I started after that happened, we were just aware that that was like a big thing that had just kind of just occurred. So that was on our minds. And although, like I said, the archive documents so many different places across the world, Iraq, obviously, it holds information and documentation that really refers to a hugely important part of Iraq's history. That kind of became a topic that seemed to work and seemed to be quite particularly relevant at the moment. We looked at different spaces for the exhibition, and given what we wanted to talk about, the space that we've used in the Great North Museum really stood out as the best, because we thought we could do a lovely photographic exhibition in a smaller space, but we couldn't really get into things.
You lose that immersion as well for the people visiting.
Yeah, and it is a hugely complicated topic, as I've found out, having to kind of understand it. And we just couldn't really get into kind of like the meat and bones of it, as it were. But one thing that we were really kind of set on doing with the exhibition was telling the story and broadening kind of people's understanding of the country and of the Middle East, obviously making them aware of Bell and the archive, but also really representing the people that she captures, as well as just sticking to the facts and also talking about her, which is kind of why we even, and it's obviously quite a small thing, but even in the title of the exhibition, rather than saying Challenging Legacies, Gertrude Bell and the Kingdom of Iraq, we flipped that mm-hmm. because there is a tendency to focus on her, which is legitimate because she is obviously very interesting. But there are so many people, so much culture, so much kind of like rich landscape of these places, socially and culturally, as well as geographically, captured in the archive.
For me, who's someone who's studied this locally as part of my degree and an interest to me, I think like exhibitions like this are really important to like, again, really ground it and like materialise it and again, like immerse people actually that this is not just a place that's over there, it's like a real place, you know. Even though Iraq is 100 years old in 2021, it's still an ever-changing place, especially with the events of the last 20 years, you know.
Absolutely.
I think it's really important for someone who has a geography background and geopolitical background. So
yeah, and I think that's one of the really fantastic things about the archive. Valentina mentioned about Gertrude Bell and the archive and that sort of the tension, if you like. It's the archive itself which is an UNESCO international memory of the world. So Gertrude Bell in many ways is controversial. Some people might like her, she's a person from history. But one of the things that she left behind that's so important is not just her legacy in Iraq, but also this archive that we have here on campus. So we've got nearly 8,000 photographs, or over 8,000 photographs, actually. I think you've digitized with Graham nearly 12,000 unique objects. All of those are now on the website. So we're sharing those from Newcastle, literally for the world.
There we go, from Newcastle.
Absolutely, and it's on the new website. So that's a fantastic resource for people here on campus who can go to Special Collections and work with Valentina and other archivists here. But because it's now available in such detail on the internet, people all around the world can engage with it. And I think that in itself is a really significant thing for us to share, you know, internationally. It's something that's recognised by UNESCO. And it means we can engage with some of these challenging legacies critically, because we've actually got the source material, the primary source material created at the time. And obviously that has to be considered in context, has to be considered critically. But it means we can enter into those kind of interpretations that perhaps you were talking about just now.
So obviously it's great having everything sort of online and accessible for everybody. But what can visitors expect to see when they actually visit the exhibition?
One of the things that strikes you straight away is these fantastic photographs. Graham has been scanning all the original negatives and the quality of detail that you can get from those nitrate negatives, which have to be kept in cold storage because they can spontaneously combust, they say. So they say. I think they're safe in their conserved state, but those have been blown up meters, probably 4-5 meters, some of them. So they're really impressive, and you can really see the detail on those photographs. You can really engage. Some of the people represented are life size, so you can almost walk up to these faces from 100 years ago and engage with them. So I think that's really wonderful. But there are many things. Tell us about some more, Valentina.
So I mentioned earlier about we thought we could have a photographic exhibition, and then we thought we want to really get into the subject. But actually, the way that we've done it, I think we get the best of both worlds. So there's cases. Obviously, you can expect cases with objects in them. The cases are, they pretty much represent all the different formats that we have. So there are letters, all original. Well, actually, in fact, all original except for when there's a facsimile, because some things have been put together in one volume. So if we wanted to display like three documents from one volume, we can't. Sometimes there are facsimiles, but most of it, original. There's letters, there's physical photographs, books that belong to her that's been annotated, reports, like published material. So it represents the real kind of like array of things that we have in the archive. But on the backs of the cases, so you're looking around the outside and you see in, so you see all the objects. But if you go inside, around the back, we've put big panels with, as Mark said, like kind of blown up photographs with people. You could easily go, and if you really wanted, you could just ignore all of the writing, the facts, and you could just enjoy the photographs. So that is a big part of the exhibition that we really didn't want to leave out. Obviously, we can't tell the entire story because it's not possible and it's incredibly complicated, but you can expect to come learn a little bit about the history of Mesopotamia, learn that Iraq was part of Mesopotamia for a start, because this is like, I started this job and I had to learn so much. And like what you were saying about, it's very easy for your knowledge of the country to be overtaken by the last 20 years, the media, what's been in the news, the conflict that's happened. So I grew up being very aware of Iraq because of the 2003 war. We were aware that that can easily be your first and maybe only interaction, especially if you're of a certain age. But what you can expect is to come and find out the context and the background a little bit. Of course, it's a long history. And also the context and background of Bill. You can also expect to learn about the First World War, but maybe a side of that conflict that we're not told about. And I think more about what I want people to leave thinking rather than what they're going to expect going in. So I hope that people leave and they kind of go, do you know, like things maybe fall into place a little bit and they want to kind of go away and find out more.
I was going to say there's some wonderful objects as well in their own right. So right in the middle is this big tin trunk with lettering on it that says it shouldn't be opened until 1945. So this is one of the cases in which that original archive was brought. It was donated in, when was it? 1926, October 1926. She died in July. So just 3 months after she died, we got this first donation to the university. We've got a huge number of books, and one of the books that's been chosen was published at the end of the 19th century, but it's actually a 14th century manuscript. And you can see it's in Arabic, and Gertrude has put in pencil next to a huge number of the words her little annotations, because she's working really hard in order to translate these texts. She's really engaging with the literature of the time. So the book is valuable in its own right, but it's also an artifact that tells us about Gertrude Bell as a person and the kind of the knowledge that she had, which is actually quite important if we want to understand the extent to which she was familiar with the place where she was working. She wrote when she arrived in Mesopotamia in 1916, she arrives at the intelligence department. She says, "Nobody here speaks Arabic." And what that tells you about the intelligence department, I leave you to guess. So she is conscious that if she's engaging with this place and making decisions about this place, she's genuinely interested in its culture and its literature and other things. Another letter I think Valentina picked, which I think is absolutely fantastic and really important to have there, is a letter from A.T. Wilson, who is the acting civil commissioner in Iraq when the Arab revolt was taking place and the British had taken over from the Ottomans. Things had been going reasonably well, and then they didn't hand over power to the local people and there was a revolt. And it's quite clear that when A.T. Wilson is writing in this letter to Gertrude, telling her that she's undermining him, and he's been talking to Sir Percy Cox, his predecessor, about this problem. And it's really interesting to see that tension, isn't it, between A.T. Wilson, her boss, and Gertrude. And he was very much a colonialist. He came from India, and she wanted Arab self-determination. So there was a kind of clash of ideas going on there. And
part of the issue as well in that letter from Wilson is that he is annoyed that she has been expressing her own views in letters to other people, which is funny because we have all the letters to her parents, and that's probably... might be other ones as well that he's talking about, but she talks very candidly and she tells her father exactly what is going on and exactly what she thinks about it. I mean, even in the First World War, she writes that she's been able to bypass the censor. So she's very much like determined to tell them what's going on and determined to tell them exactly what she thinks. And there's not much that is critical of her within the archive, because obviously most of it is her. It's her writing that we have. But that's kind of like the other side of that, that maybe you don't think about. And he's like more or less saying, you know, you're not saying the party line. You not only are you thinking something else, but you're telling people that, and you can't do that.
But I think it's important that you sort of mentioned these things, because we learn about World War One like quite widely in like, I remember GCSE history, and like the whole like Middle East and like the collapse of the Ottoman Empire was just like a side note.
Yeah. Did you learn about it? Because I always feel like it's the World War One, but one seems to learn about the Western Front and maybe Gallipoli, but I don't remember learning about it when I was at school.
And no one knew like the role that like Britain had in all of this stuff as well.
Yeah, I mean, you suspect that it should become more part of the curriculum now because of the fact that Iraq has been so much in our news, that perhaps that story so visibly needs to be told, whereas perhaps 30 years ago people hadn't really 40 years ago perhaps people hadn't they were focusing on the Western Front more.
I don't know that it's told in, from what I'm actually struggling to remember getting taught about the First World War, which suggests it didn't make much of an impact on me. like I'm hugely personally like interested in the Second World War, and I felt when I started this job, like, well, I understand that. I don't really understand the First World War, and I've never found it to be particularly captivating. I used to have this idea when I was a teenager, when I got taught it, that it was just lots of countries with big ships and guns, like, bustling to kind of fight each other, which kind of is true, but also there's so much more strategy to it, and there was so much that was like so much of people protecting their own interests and also trying to advance themselves, because there are these new countries, like Italy has just unified, Germany are relatively young, and then there's the big empires of like Britain and Russia. And learning about all this, it just made a lot more sense. And I get, like you said, it it's not gone away. The need to find and protect oil, the need to have space, like more space, you know, like kind of colonize, like it's you still see the ramifications today. And obviously the ramifications from that, you could say, led onto what happened in the Second World War. And also just other aspects. So the different demographics of soldiers, the amount of Indian soldiers, for example, like I wasn't very aware of. And unfortunately, there is only so much space on the walls in the GNM Hancock in our exhibition. But that is something that became very clear. And I just kind of want to go back to what we were saying about what to expect when you go to the exhibition, because kind of what Mark was saying about the books reminded me and made me think that there are a few, like, so the exhibition tells the story of Bell and Iraq, and it starts at the beginning with a little kind of like overview of their history before they meet, as it were, and then it ends with Bell's death with a little bit about kind of post Bell's death Iraq, an absolute complete overview, because that's a lot of history to squeeze into a little space. But it also tells smaller stories in microcosm. So in regards to the books, we have the poetry, the Divan of Hafiz poetry, Persian poetry. We have the Arabic and German translation that was done, 1890 something, before Bell, basically, before Bell did hers. There's this one. She has that book and she's annotated it, so she's been translating it. And then she publishes her own translation in English. So we have her initially annotated one that she's working on, then we have like her published one, so you can kind of see the transition. You see her learning language and translating other texts, and also learning about history and culture in those texts. But we also have some envelopes that are picked from different letters kind of throughout the archive, like going kind of through time. And this is like my pet interest, is the stamps on them, because I never realized stamps were so interesting, and now I've started collecting them because I realized. So like you have, for example, in one letter there's the Ottoman stamp, because it's the Ottoman Empire, and then a little bit later you see the British occupation in Iraq, but it's actually an Ottoman stamp being printed over with that text. And then a little bit later on you see an Iraqi stamp, and that's the first set during Bell's lifetime that was created for the Kingdom of Iraq, but it's in English and Arabic. It's in annas, which is in rupees, which is Indian currency, because Iraq doesn't have its own currency yet, even though it has a king and it's a kingdom, and it's been drawn by British artists. So you see that duality continuing, and you can just track the trajectory of the country through that, which I think is really interesting.
I was just going to say, those stamps as well, they've got images of the archaeology, haven't they?
Yeah, drawn by British artists, picked by British people.
So it's really interesting to see how, because of Bell's influence, but also because of the significance of Mesopotamia for the, you know, these great civilizations of the past, you know, they're taking monuments from that history and putting them on the stamp, so they become really iconic images for the new state. And so the archaeology is sort of linked to the kind of the identity of this new state that's just been recently formed. I think that's quite important, and it's one of the things that was part of Bell's legacy, you know, as well as one of the other things she did was form the first museum in Baghdad. So using the archaeology in that way to tell the long-term story of this place from centuries, millennia earlier, right the way through to the present, and forming, using it as part of forming that identity in the present is really quite important.
So are you both pleased with how the exhibition has been perceived so far by visitors?
I am. I think that I and we were incredibly aware when we were telling the story that it's complicated, and it's a big responsibility because it's not my story. I'm not from Iraq. I don't have any relatives who are from Iraq.
There's an ongoing geography joke that the more you learn about Iraq, the less you know about Iraq.
Well, it's, I mean, it's just, it is, yeah, I think that we all wanted to do justice to this. We wanted people to be pleased. We wanted people to feel that they were represented. We did have support from very, very generous and kind and patient Iraqi colleagues within the university. But it was still a little bit hard, a bit scary, and you do kind of put yourself on the line. But, you know, I just wanted to do my best, and I do think that I have done as well as I can do, and it has been really well received, and I'm really, really grateful for that.
I think it's been really encouraging, actually, because we, that, you know, once the text was kind of prepared, we then circulated it around a large number of people, didn't we? And, and lots of different people picked up on little details and said, well, let's tweak this bit, let's change that bit, or, you know, and I think that certainly gave me confidence that it had been tackled from lots of different angles, and that hopefully we hadn't fallen into too many traps. And also to have, really importantly, those Iraqi voices in there is absolutely essential. I mean, we've had a big group of people from several different universities and government heritage agencies in Iraq came to visit last week, and it was a real delight to be able to show them the various artifacts and manuscripts. Not archaeological artifacts, I mean, you know, the trunk or the book that's been annotated or the photographs, you know, these to show them these things and to see how excited they were to see them. And that, you know, that was really great. So I think for me, that was a real highlight, the fact that they seemed to appreciate it and enjoy it.
I felt like that when someone who was visiting recognised someone that was in one of the photographs. Really? As like it was the leader of the tribe that his family is part of, that his kind of lineage is from, and he was like so excited, and he was like, oh, that's who that is. And I knew because it was in the caption, and I knew what I'd written for that photograph, but seeing that real personal connection is kind of one of the things that I love about my job, because it's different when it's your people and your history, and you see yourself in that. And that's one of the reasons that we included so many photographs for people that would see themselves or would recognise, but also for people that have no connection, but they make that human connection because they see someone that's just like themselves. So there's lots of like, there's nice pictures, like kind of street scenes with just different types of people, men, women, children, and you identify with that on a kind of real human level rather than it just being this faraway place. But that was really, really exciting. I was really pleased with that because he was so happy.
How can our listeners find out more? Obviously, they can go and visit the exhibition.
We have a dedicated Gertrude Bell website, which has just been relaunched with all of the beautiful digitised images of the photographs, the letters and diaries, that gives basically the closest that you can get to seeing them in real life without coming to see them in real life. Of course, you can come and see them in real life. You can request them at Special Collections. But you can also browse online. You can see her handwritten pages. You can see the pressed flowers that she's put in her diaries. You can see the letters and the stamps. And the exhibition is on at the Great North Museum, Hancock, until the 5th of March.
Now, a question which sort of rounds up every From Newcastle podcast episode is, we like to make it personal about you guys. Now, with your stories which you told at the start, you've obviously ended up in Newcastle, but in quite different ways. But what's your favourite part about Newcastle as a city?
I think I have a few things. I like that it doesn't feel like I'm far from home. Like, I get the same vibe. I got the similar vibe in Liverpool. Everybody is so friendly, and it's just a really cool place to live. It's just, I don't really know how, it's not something I can put into words, but it's just a similar vibe. But I also love Tynemouth Market. So that's one of my highlights. Don't really have anything like that.
I always say it to everybody that it tugs on my heartstrings, and you can't explain why, but
yeah,
it's just Newcastle, it's home. So
I live in Shieldfield, sort of
so do
in
I.
the heart of the Newcastle, surrounded by students with my wife and three children, since 1992, so over 30 years. I was away for a little bit, lived in Australia for a bit and came back. I think particularly the people and also, actually, to be fair, I mean, the resources at the university and the people at the university. I love my colleagues in archaeology and the resources that we have to work with, resources like the Gertrude Bell Archive. You know, we live in a wonderful city. everywhere you go, people chat to you, people are friendly, and we work with amazing facilities. I think it's a fantastic place to work and a fantastic place to live, raise a family. I came as a student and I'm afraid I'm still here.
And you know what? You can find a Greggs on every corner. Yeah. That's my favourite activity, actually, when I bring people to visit. I'm like, let's count the Greggs in the city centre, and there's always more than you think there's going to be.
So brilliant. Thank you very much for coming on to the From Newcastle podcast.
Thank you.
If you would like to find out more about Challenging Legacies, the Kingdom of Iraq and Gertrude Bell, visit podcasts.ncl.ac.uk/from Newcastle. Next time, we'll be joined by Owen Hopkins to discuss the opening of the Farrell Centre, a new centre for architecture and cities at Newcastle University. Thank you for listening to this episode of From Newcastle. If you enjoyed it, then please click the subscribe button. We'd love to hear your comments or suggestions, so please get in touch at fromnewcastlepodcast@ncl.ac.uk or via social media at fromnclpodcast.